Well, first, I'm delighted and very honored to be here. I have a little presentation that I put together. I was asked to talk about why one should build a startup in Europe and not go to Silicon Valley. So to give you a bit of context, I lived in Silicon Valley for about 8 years. I lived in the US for 10. I have dual citizenship, American and French, which has made it easy for me to work both in Europe and in the US. And I studied at Stanford right when Silicon Valley was booming, loved it, fell into technology, loved consumer technology. And I worked for a number of startups, and then for eBay. When I joined eBay, it was probably, I worked in product management. The whole company was 1,000 people. The product management team was 20 people. So it was quite an experience to work at a company that wasn't a startup anymore, but wasn't a huge corporation, and learn from that. And so then I went to business school. I did 2 years of business school, and I worked at a startup called Skype in London between the 2 years of business school. That was before the first acquisition of Skype by eBay. And so I really saw some of the differences between the European ecosystem, European startups, and the Silicon Valley ecosystem of startups. Now, that was in 2005, so a long time ago, and it has changed tremendously. I then worked in venture capital at XL Partners after business school, and after 2.5 years of that, started my own company with my co-founder, which is Batika. And did that for about 5 years. In April, I left and joined Google Ventures in September. So I'm giving you the perspective of someone who's been a founder, who's been an investor, who's been a product manager, an employee of startups and large companies. And I'm very happy that I chose, after business school, to come back to Europe. So I'd spent 10 years in the US and to start sort of the next phase of my career in Europe. So let me tell you a little bit more. There's some very basic things that I'm going to go through and talk through from my experience of what it is. So it's, a lot of people will talk about these things in general as what makes an ecosystem great to build for entrepreneurship, from talent to having a large market for your customers, whether it's business or consumer, access to capital. And that's all sorts of capital, from angel to growth capital, a connected ecosystem. And I think Ben actually touched on that at the end, talking about the connections in Silicon Valley. But that's something that has grown here in a tremendous way. Friendly policies and regulations, which is extremely important, and exit opportunities. So let's start with international talent in a global market. This was very important for me. When we started Batika, we actually thought, should we do it? It's a fashion startup. So we thought, Silicon Valley doesn't make sense. They don't really get fashion. They don't really get that side of it. So it's either New York or it's London for us. And we decided London for many reasons. One, the talent that it attracts. So building a global company, you want to have people within the company that understand various cultures, that understand the different markets that you're going to go into. And London is a perfect place for this. You have a melting pot of all sorts of people who are extremely smart and talented who come to London and from all over Europe and from the US. So that was extremely important. We also, because we were building a global marketplace, we wanted to be at the center of time zone. So we have about 300 brands and designers from 40 different countries on our site, which meant being able to access, talk to that talent. And doing it from New York would have been more difficult than doing it from London. So those are some of the reasons why we wanted to be here. And then from a talent perspective, and this, again, in the last few years has changed tremendously. There are so many people who have worked at large companies like Google, Facebook, eBay, Amazon, these guys have their head, some of their main European headquarters in London, and employ lots of incredible talent, whether it's marketing, engineering. And we now have access to these people who have worked at these companies, have learned a tremendous amount, and want to work at startups. So not only is there a talent pool, but it's a talent pool who wants to engage in startups. And I saw that difference from when I was here in 2005 and then started my company in 2009-2010. And to give you an example, our head of marketing for Batika was, we recruited her because of her experience. She was Indian with a Dutch Indian, so had lots of and lived in London. So from a culture standpoint, she had a lot of connections. But she also had worked at My Wardrobe, which for us was significant, and had set up their marketing. She had worked for offline a retailer in marketing, understood that, and had worked for a very large affiliate marketing network. And so she brought all of this into our company and with all that knowledge and talent. And that's extremely important because you all, when you start a company, the most important aspect of it is getting people that are better at you, at all the things that you are not that great at. And that resource is really available here. And then on top of that, Ben mentioned that there's so many schools, whether it's in the UK, whether it's in Germany, in France, that now, because of the culture of entrepreneurship, we as startup have access to in terms of recruiting them. These guys more and more are looking for entrepreneurial opportunities as opposed to going into a big corporation. And the global market aspect has its good size and its bad size. So unlike in the US where it's one market, which is pretty homogeneous, you do have differences between France and Germany and the UK and Poland that you have to address. At the same time, it's a very big barrier to entry if you're able to master that and understand that through the talent that you bring on board. And the last thing I'll say on the talent is because years have passed, you are getting more serial entrepreneurs in the ecosystem, which makes a huge difference, which is what brings Silicon Valley its advantage. It's not only because you have the Googles and the Facebooks and the Yahoos there, but it's because you have these serial entrepreneurs that come back with their learning in the ecosystem and big build companies and help mentor others. Access to smart capital. Again, this has changed. So I looked up the numbers to give you exact numbers, but apparently, according to Preqin, over 6 billion euros were invested in 2013 in Europe alone, which was up 42% in venture capital money. 15% of that was Series A, so there's a lot of capital. And there's capital at various levels. There are angels and super angels. There's advantages you get in the UK, for example, with EIS and ECIS for tax advantage, which allows very early money to come into your companies. You have all the, there's a concentration in the UK of VCs, but there are in Germany, in Spain, in France as well. You have the big names, but we were making a list the other day with my colleagues of all the of the VC ecosystem. And within each category of growth, there's at least more than a dozen of VCs to talk to. And then once you go past that stage, from a growth perspective, there's other people also that invest, whether it's sort of later stage VCs or private equity. And you see more and more US venture capital firms entering the European market to find investment. So Benchmark, which is a great brand in the US, has come invested in Europe. One example is Matt Kohler in ResearchGate, which is a German company. Union Square Ventures, is that AC? has invested here from New York. So, and you'll see more and more of these. Google Ventures just opened in Europe because there's a real opportunity that we're looking at in Europe from an investment standpoint. So, the access to capital is here. The large market with and talent is here. And then what's happened as well is that there's a thriving entrepreneurial ecosystem, and the importance is ecosystem. So having lived and worked in Silicon Valley, that was the best aspect of it, is that the universities, so I went to Stanford, and the VCs and the companies and the professors were all basically interconnected. You would be sent from one company to the other, to the professor, to the VC, and that's how it worked beautifully. And there's a real culture of wanting to share that knowledge, share that information, and build together. And this has grown here through various activity. One is here, you're sitting all here because of that. This 5 years ago didn't exist. And there's so many more of these opportunities. So whether it's through Seed Camp that organizes events, whether it's corporates that come and build these ecosystems. So Facebook does a lot of work with the ecosystem, helping developers, helping entrepreneurs. Google built Google Campus, not only here, but in Germany with the factory, helping with that, and elsewhere in Europe. So there's a real willingness, but also real activity that you can see people involved in doing this, from all sorts of events to conferences that you can go to. But most importantly, there's a willingness from entrepreneurs, whether they're serial entrepreneurs or first-time entrepreneurs or people that are in these big companies that have learned a lot, to share. So, and again, that's the most important. Most entrepreneurs will learn from other entrepreneurs. They learn from individuals who are local to them. And the willingness to mentor and to transfer that knowledge here is incredible. You simply need to ask. One of my mottos is don't ask, don't get. And when I was doing Batika, the number of advisors that I found simply by asking for their knowledge and their help on this or that was invaluable. And this is something that makes Silicon Valley what it is because of its knowledge sharing and what exists here today. And you'll see, I'll give you another example. There are resources online that you can find. So two of my partners, one is Izzy Vidra and Tom Hulme, both have blogs. And on their blogs in their past, Tom used to be at IDEO, so he built a resource to share with everyone on what are the tools that are useful for startups that can use. And that's something that is sort of an open source tool where all sorts of people can come and add to it. And that is part of this knowledge sharing. Izzy has done the same thing on his blog for VC Cafe. So there's a real willingness to share all this information. This one is, a lot of people often forget, but it's very important, which is the incentives around to help startups. So we had at Batika, we benefited from R&D tax benefits. So for about every year, I think we were there, we got anywhere between 20,000 to 50,000 pounds of tax relief. So check comes from the government. Here you go, there's 30,000 pounds for you because of the research and development work that we did. And that's extremely important. It helps innovation, it helps startups to build. Entrepreneur relief, so if you sell your company, you have a certain capital gains tax that is limited here to 10% up to, I think it's 10 million pounds, which makes a difference, a significant difference, and that's another incentive. Employment laws are becoming more flexible for startups as well. There's a real activity around that. You see the involvement of, you look at the government and the activity that they're doing through Tech City. Joanna Shields is now advising the Prime Minister, and she comes from a real tech background. It's somebody who's been on the ground doing all this work and understands the technology ecosystem, who's helping shape these regulations and policies and make it better for us as entrepreneurs to build companies. And this is what exists in the US and in Silicon Valley, which makes it very attractive as well, and it's happening, it's happened here too. And then lastly, exit opportunities. So you may be an entrepreneur who wants to build a lifestyle business. That is all well and good. And you can get the capital for that. But for those of you who want to get more investment, who have the big idea, who are looking to build that, there are examples now, many examples of companies who've done that in Europe, from recently Supercell, who a gaming company that sold for $1.5 billion to SoftBank. And it's a Finnish company, to DeepMind here that was bought by Google, to Net-a-Porter in the fashion world that was bought by Richemont. And these are all very big outcomes. There is Price Minister a number of years ago in France that sold to Rakuten, it's a Japanese company, Skype to eBay. So companies are coming from Asia, from the US, within Europe, to acquire talent, to acquire innovation, to acquire growth. And that's very important because that shows to investors that that's, you know, it's a great place to invest. It brings more talent to the table, and it allows you guys to think big, just as big as one can think in Silicon Valley. So for all these reasons that are tangible reasons, we decided we wanted to build Batika here. And I think that it shows you that it is an incredibly thriving ecosystem, that there's tons of opportunity to build something great here without having to go to Silicon Valley. Now, you can tap into Silicon Valley because the ecosystem is not closed. So there's tons of ties from the Valley into Europe through investors, through big corporations, through advisors that you have. And you should do that. You should always figure out what is happening there, what are the new technologies that are coming in. But you don't need to be there to build a very large company today.